All right, so we're going to continue on. This is section two now, so we'll do the rest of neurology, then we'll cover HIV, STDs, Hep C is in that next section, and then the third one is, I forget, PEDS, pediatrics, I believe. So then we'll do, is it PEDS? It might not be PEDS, we'll see. Whatever it is, it's uploaded, so you can check that out. So moving on, first things we'll do is Parkinson's disease. So what is Parkinson's disease? What do you guys know about it? Michael J. Fox. Muhammad Ali. Okay. So, how would you describe someone who had Parkinson's? Resting tremor. Good. Ataxic gait. Kind of shuffling gait. Pill roll. Yeah. So really, the big issue here is going to be they have a hard time kind of initiating movements, right? So that's where you see a lot of these issues come from. It's this kind of hypokinesia that you see. So the kind of four cardinal features, I see tremor, rigidity, that hypokinesia, and this kind of postural instability. Have you covered this anywhere else yet? Okay, so we'll talk a little bit about the pathophysiology, how it relates back to the pharmacology for the medications we're going to use, and hopefully that'll kind of key you guys in when you cover this in your neurology section. So anywho, there's lots of different possible causes for why Parkinson's occurs in the first place. There could be some genetic predispositions. You know, people like Michael J. Fox were developing kind of early on in life. Maybe that was something that was going on with him. You can see it just happened kind of idiopathically with just kind of age-related degeneration. And then actually there are some secondary causes you can see with this. This is an interesting story is that, you know, back in the day when people were trying to make kind of their own kind of street versions of different kinds of drugs of abuse. And so some guy was trying to make street Demerol, basically. You guys remember Demerol, right? Yeah. So he was trying to make his own kind of version of that on the street. And what he didn't realize, he actually made a drug that completely depleted all of his dopamine neurons, basically just kind of wiped them all out. And so when they found the patient, and basically patients who have like really severe Parkinson's, like how would you describe them? No movement whatsoever. They're catatonic, right? Because they have no dopamine to initiate these movements. So this patient actually was completely catatonic. And when they found that he had fried all of his neurons because he made this kind of byproduct that they, you know, because obviously street chemists may not have the best equipment or the best methods out there. So he made this thing, though, that fried all of his dopamine neurons. And so they actually were able to use that chemical and were able to use it for like animal studies and whatnot to kind of represent the disease model for Parkinson's. So his mistake actually ended up leading to a lot of good research about Parkinson's and were able to kind of recreate realistic models of that. So it's kind of an interesting thing. But certainly anything that is blocking dopamine can lead to these effects. So we haven't covered behavioral stuff yet, but you will see that when we get to the antipsychotics, a lot of them are blocking dopamine. They can cause very similar side effects to what look like Parkinson's. We'll talk about extrapyramidal side effects and how those look very similar to this. Okay. Use of trauma. That MPTP was that chemical that I was mentioning just there that the chemist had made. But other things you can see that can deplete dopaminergic neurons in the CNS include hydrogen sulfide, methanol, all kinds of other kind of chemical entities out there can do this as well. So what are we having issues with here? So essentially we're looking at the substantia nigra. And we have these dopaminergic projections that are going to ultimately synapse up here in the striatum. Okay, so the striatum is going to have basically two different neuron types for dopamine. You're going to have the stimulatory D1 receptors or neurons. You're going to have the inhibitory D2 projections. Okay, so this is going to be important for kind of figuring out how we're seeing this kind of hypokinesia, and a lot of it is relating to this disbalance between the D1 and the D2s, right? So. Essentially what you're seeing here, and I'll use my laser pointer so we can follow along, like our lasers. Okay, so what is happening in a normal human brain when you kind of think, okay, in the frontal cortex, I would like to move. This is the process that's happening here. So essentially you have your D1 projections here and you have your D2 in the striatum. Normally with these D1, when these D1 receptors get activated, they are working to send out GABA, right? So they're stimulating GABA to be released. And we know GABA is inhibitory or stimulatory. It's inhibitory, right? So we know that from our neurology section for the first part. So normally this will synapse here over into this globus pallidus interna, and this will have an inhibitory activity here, right? And so this means this will actually help to kind of shut off this neuron, which would normally fire GABA. So this is, again, when you inhibit an inhibitory neuron, ultimately you have a stimulatory effect, right? Right, so if I were to have more activity here, you have more GABA floating out here into this globus pallidus interna, that would ultimately inhibit this one, leading to less inhibitory activity coming out of here. So the thalamus will actually have kind of stimulatory actions on motor cortex, right? Red lines are stimulatory, black lines are inhibitory, just for your reference. So the counterbalance to that, to make sure that you don't have kind of unchecked movement, is going to be these D2 receptors. So when you activate these, this will fire off GABA into the synapse and will interact here with this globus pallidus externa. This will then inhibit this GABAergic neuron here into the substantia nigra. So it's normally inhibiting this, and so then this one ultimately will release glutamate onto here. So if this one releases more glutamate, then you'll ultimately have more GABA interacting with the thalamus, and that would inhibit movement, okay? So keep that in mind. So this will make more sense when you get into the actual disease picture in just a second here. But so again, this has to be kept in balance, otherwise you run the risk of having too much movement or too little movement occurring when you have that kind of initial stimulus to do so. So what happens when you have Parkinson's disease is you ultimately have kind of a depletion of these dopaminergic neurons coming from the substantia nigra, right? So you have less activity on both the D1 and the D2 receptors, okay? So what does that mean for us? So initially, when you have less activity here on the D1 receptors, that means the striatum is sending out less GABA. So there's less of an inhibitory activity, which means you're going to have this one sending out more GABA, right? Because it's lost the brakes essentially, okay? And then on the flip side, you have here, even though this D2 is going to have less activity, it's still having a little bit of dopaminergic activity. And again, this is a progressive disease. So this is going to be happening kind of on a scale as more and more of those neurons get depleted. But basically, by having kind of unchecked activity here, you're going to be inhibiting this GABAergic neuron. So you're going to have less GABA activity, which means you're going to have more glutamate activity. So this one basically has the brakes taken off of it and has more gas being put onto it. And so you have a lot more GABA flowing out from this globus pallidus interna. Okay, so that means you have a lot more inhibitory action on the thalamus and less movement occurring from the motor cortex. Right, so less dopamine means we're less able to initiate a movement when you have that stimulation to do so. Okay. So if my front of my brain is telling me to walk, it's going to have a hard time initiating that movement, which is why you kind of have that shuffling gait, right? And if I had a total depletion of it, that's why you find patients in this kind of catatonic state where they can't move whatsoever because they just can't initiate these movements because there's no GABA or no dopamine to be sent out. Have you guys ever seen the movie Awakenings? Mm-hmm. With I think at least Al Pacino is in that? Check out that movie. It's a really good one where basically it's looking at Parkinson's patients. They're all living in this kind of asylum. This is like, you know, set back in the, I'm not even sure what time, probably in the 40s or 50s or something. But basically it was before we had any kind of modern treatment for Parkinson's. And so this is kind of the discovery of L-DOPA and how this was actually able to return some degree of function to these patients. And so they basically go from having like no activity whatsoever to actually like being able to just talk and converse. And, you know, it's almost like they're kind of locked in during this phase. And so it was really kind of interesting to watch that movie and see how this how the drugs are really kind of working to affect their quality of life. Is it on Netflix? Fantastic. So go watch that. That's non-mandatory homework from your pharma professor.
So it's lack of dopamine, not a neuron receptor problem.
Yeah, it's more of an issue is that the substantia nigra, which normally is housing a lot of these dopaminergic neurons, are being depleted over time, right? So as those neurons get destroyed, which when that street chemist developed that MPTP, basically he was frying his whole substantia nigra of all these dopaminergic neurons, so there's just no activity here, right? So again, it's just not enough dopamine to really start those movements, and so you just have kind of an over-inhibitory activity on that thalamus, and thus it can't initiate the movement through the motor cortex.
But it's not too much GABA, it just means you don't have enough dopamine.
As a secondary effect, you end up having kind of too much GABA transmission occurring, but it's not like I can give a GABA antagonist and I would fix my problem, right? It all goes back to not having enough dopamine, okay? So again, this is why you see the same effects. If you were to block these dopamine receptors with something like an antipsychotic, you end up having these kind of acute dystonic reactions where basically they have kind of this kind of locked kind of feel to them where they might be, there's one good story I'll tell you about when you get to the behavioral section, but essentially, yeah, you get these acute dystonias, but these EPS-like symptoms or extrapyramidal side effects are looks very much like Parkinson's because you're basically blocking the dopamine that the patient already would be sending out anyway, okay? So this will be integral to knowing why the medications we're using to help these patients work.
So where there are the tremors, like the uncontrollable movements?
That is probably going to be related more towards acetylcholine. So we'll talk about that counterbalance here in just a minute. Yep. Okay, so just to kind of show the opposite of this, so we have something like Huntington's disease. So you guys know what Huntington's is? Hmm? So, you know, like Huntington's chorea, like, so basically these patients kind of have the opposite problem where they have like too much muscle movement or too kind of involuntary motion that's happening. So I talk about that chorea that they have where they kind of almost have that kind of dance that they end up doing as they have this progressive disease. This is kind of an opposite problem where they end up having not enough of this kind of inhibitory D2 action here. And so you end up having kind of an overactivity at the thalamus. And so you have more movement being initiated there. Okay, so they're kind of the opposite problem. We don't have a ton of good treatments for it, but some of the things you can use are some of those dopamine blockers. So we'll talk about those in the behavioral section, but we actually have one drug that's specifically marketed for this called this tetrabenazine or xenazine as the brand name is. And so this one actually works by just depleting the catecholamines, right? So it depletes things like norepinephrine and dopamine and actually will end up inhibiting those movements, right? So it's kind of an opposite way of attacking the problem when you have, you know, basically the disease is the opposite of Parkinson's in a way. A lot of kind of issues with this. Anytime you're depleting catecholamines from the CNS, like serotonin, norepinephrine, dopamine, you see a lot of psychiatric issues pop up and you see a lot of cardiovascular instability. So hypotension, depression, suicidality. You see this with other drugs that can deplete catecholamines as well. So obviously, you know, it's kind of a double-edged sword, risk versus benefits of having this kind of really, you know, poor quality of life due to the kind of involuntary movement versus the risk of these other medications. So just to kind of get the counterbalance to Parkinson's, that's how Huntington's kind of works. So normally when you have dopamine, normally dopamine is being balanced with acetylcholine, right? And so acetylcholine we know is important for acting on things like the skeletal muscle receptors. That's what's causing them to activate, right? So that's why giving too much acetylcholine can cause fasciculations and things like that. Same thing's happening here where you have a disbalance where you have less dopamine, meaning you're going to have overactivity of acetylcholine. And thus, when you have that, that's why you end up seeing the tremor there. So basically, you're having a little bit kind of too sensitive of muscle act, you know, kind of fine muscle activation. Okay? Does that make sense? So just know it's kind of a seesaw pattern where if you decrease the activity of dopamine, you're going to have too much acetylcholine activity. And so that's going to be important when we look at some of the medications you can use to reverse that. So for instance, if I were to give a patient who had an acute dystonic reaction due to a dopamine blocker that was blocking all this activity of dopamine, you know they have too much acetylcholine. Well, the drug to fix that, I'm going to give an anticholinergic. So I can use something like Benadryl or I can use Cogentin. We'll talk about those when we get to that section. But basically, you're trying to restore that balance between acetylcholine and dopamine to fix that issue. Okay, so just know this gets out of whack. We'll look at some drugs that are going to be affecting this process in order to help some of these symptoms out. Okay, but this is where the tremor is coming from. Okay, so how is dopamine kind of processed in the neuron itself? So where do you think we get the kind of the precursors for dopamine from in our diet? Amino acids. So some amino acids, right? So there's some special ones. So things like phenylalanine can be used here. We'll see things that tyrosine is going to be a big one. So we'll look at, especially when we get to the behavioral section, tyrosine is going to be a big interactor with some of our medications like the monoamine oxidase inhibitors. We'll talk about those later. But just know that tyrosine is a big component of your diet that can be affecting this. And that'll be important for some drug interactions a little bit later on. But essentially what you end up seeing is that tyrosine gets being converted by this enzyme over to L-DOPA. And that'll be important when we talk about some of the medications we're going to use. But the L-DOPA eventually is going to get converted over to dopamine, where it can be utilized for normal transmission, right? There's some enzymes that are responsible for metabolizing dopamine. So you have things like this catecholamine O-methyltransferase, or COMT. That's going to be responsible for metabolizing this kind of precursor L-DOPA, right? And then another important enzyme is this monoamine oxidase B. This is a specific enzyme that will break down the dopamine for it to be kind of recycled eventually. So one of the ways that, you know, if we know we have too little dopamine working in the CNS, how can we fix that problem? Good. So that's one mechanism we can shoot for is to inhibit those enzymes, right? So if we limit the breakdown of the enzymes, the dopamine sticks around for longer and it's going to have more activity, right? The other thing we could do is potentially give the patient more precursor, give them something that will actually end up helping them to produce more dopamine. So when we talk about levodopa and carbidopa, that's where that's going to be coming in. So we can kind of enhance both the supply and then also the degradation of dopamine.
Which one is dopamine itself?
Dopamine is this DA right here. And again, this dopamine will eventually be released out of these vesicles out into the synapse where they can have their actions. Normally, you'll have like a dopamine transporter, which will actually end up recycling the dopamine and kind of being able to bring it up, kind of like how we have certain other uptake transporters for things like serotonin and whatnot.
So,
with like the synapse and all that. So they're just neurons that just solely deal with dopamine, or they there's like acetylcholine and GABA, dopamine, all that stuff in the same.
Depends on the neurons. There may be some that have kind of multiple activities, but here we're specifically just focusing on the dopamine aspects of it. Yeah. So this is obviously a very simplified kind of look of it. Even it looks complicated, but it's pretty simplified compared to what's actually happening. Okay. So again, so this will be important for understanding why we're using some of the drugs that we're using to treat Parkinson's. Okay. So again, we talked about some of the signs and symptoms that you're going to see with them. So again, looking at the hypo and the bradykinesia, the resting tremor, the rigidity and postural instability, those are the kind of the cardinal signs. But there's lots of other things that you're going to see developing, especially as the disease gets more and more progressive. So, you know, having issues of them even being able to kind of perform activities of daily living becomes more difficult, as movement becomes more difficult, as even being kind of vocal becomes more difficult. So you have lots of issues there. You have some other issues with some autonomic instability. So you can have things like incontinence develop, constipation, sexual dysfunction, all of which can be affecting quality of life for them. And then you have these mental status changes as well, right? So these are all things that are going to be happening kind of as the disease gets more and more progressive. I'm going to pause for just a minute. All right. So anywho, so as far as diagnosis goes, how do you diagnose someone with Parkinson's? Is there a lab test you can do? No, not really an EEG. Really, it's all looking at their signs and symptoms, right? So you can't really do it. There's no lab test that says, yes, they have the Parkinson's disease. Oftentimes, it's really going to be found as kind of a postmortem finding. You can find, you know, degradation of the dopaminergic neurons, but it's not something we're going to do while they're still alive, right? So other things you can actually do is to give some provocative testing. So we can actually give them something to determine if their disease gets better or worse, and that will actually kind of give us a clue as to what the actual pathophysiology is going on with the patient. So for instance, if I give them a precursor to dopamine, like levodopa, I can actually end up having them produce more dopamine, and their symptoms should get better, right? So that could be one sign, right? So that could be telling me, okay, they're definitely having a diminished amount of dopamine, and this is fixing it. There's also another drug called apomorphine that we'll talk about a little bit later. It can be used as a similar diagnostic test, okay? And again, we know this is a progressive disease, so we'd like to catch this earlier if possible, but because it can be kind of insidious in its kind of onset, you may find patients a little bit later than you'd like to. And so we'll look at some drugs that may be able to help kind of halt the progression of the disease, or at least slow it down a little bit. And so if you can initiate those earlier, you might have a better time in having your patient be functional for longer. So that's kind of one of the goals. So again, so our therapeutic goal is to minimize or reverse any functional disability, and then prevent or minimize long-term complications either from the disease, or we're going to see some issues with the actual medications we're giving as well, right? So you're going to see kind of how this, we have this kind of progression of how we treat this disease and how things will become ineffective as time goes on, and how you have to kind of change therapy in order to kind of overcome that. So lots of non-pharmacologic things we can do. There are, you know, lots of like PT and OT they should be doing in order to help kind of keep up their functionality, education, and kind of support for them. Certain surgical interventions you can provide, which I'm not going to get too far into. And then we'll look at the pharmacology, where the treatment for especially early or uncomplicated PD is going to be different than we see with more kind of complicated late stage Parkinson's. So for early uncomplicated PD, we're going to talk more about these in detail, but here are some of the things we're going to look at. So there are things that we can use that will be neuroprotective, meaning they can help to kind of slow down the progression of the disease. And then we're going to see things that are working specifically for the symptoms of Parkinson's. So they're all going to be things that specifically will kind of help to restore that balance between acetylcholine and dopamine, or actually help to increase levels of dopamine to kind of restore normal functioning. Okay. So I see there's relatively few of them that are actually neuroprotective. Most of them are just going to be for symptomatic management. So with the neuroprotective ones, some of the problems that you see with dopamine metabolism is, if you're looking at here, when you have dopamine being metabolized by monoamine oxidase B, you're noticing this metabolite, but you're also, what is this right here? This H2O2. Hydrogen peroxide. So what does that turn into? Free radicals. And what do free radicals do? They damage cells, they denature proteins, and so they are thought that as you have more of this oxidative stress from these free radicals, you can see more damage to the neurons and eventually have progression of disease, right? So the idea here is, if I could inhibit this enzyme, perhaps I can have less oxidative stress, less excitatory toxicity, and hopefully I can have my dopaminergic neurons working for longer, Okay, so that's what one of some of the thoughts are. You see this especially when you get something like levodopa, which is a precursor to dopamine that actually has to be metabolized into it. So again, anytime you're giving them more dopamine to process, you can end up increasing this oxidative stress, which is why we see diminishing effects from some of our drugs over time due to this kind of progression of disease. So seeing things like initiating dopamine agonists or things to kind of replace normal acting dopamine can be useful because that helps to delay some of these kind of dyskinesias we're going to see related to levodopa and carbidopa. And then the monoamine oxidase B inhibitors just basically help to prevent that breakdown so you have less of those free radicals being formed. So that's kind of the two different ways we're going to be utilizing these drugs to help kind of help enhance our neuroprotection for these patients. Does that make sense? So what are some drugs we have for this? So a couple of drugs we have for specifically inhibiting monoamine oxidase B. And again, there's monoamine oxidase B, so that would imply there's a monoamine oxidase what?
A,
right? So we're not really worried about A. A is going to be more important when we're talking about treatment for depression. This is specifically B that we're going to be focusing on for this one. So these guys have a little bit more selectivity for that enzyme than specifically working on both A and B. But we have selegiline and rasagiline. So selegiline has been found to work to delay the need for levodopa, but you're not going to see a real sustained effect. So this could be kind of short term, but by giving this kind of early on, you may be able to prolong how long you can treat the patient before they go on to requiring L-DOPA. And we're going to see that L-DOPA is really going to be kind of the cornerstone or gold standard treatment for these Parkinson's patients. We'll talk more about that in detail in a little bit. The selegiline is actually an amphetamine derivative and gets metabolized into amphetamine. So if you ever have a patient who's on selegiline and they need to take a urine drug screen, they'll actually show positive for amphetamine. So it's a false positive to be aware of for your Parkinson's patients. It's not they like to go and do the crystal, right? They're not Walter White in their off time. But because of the amphetamine properties, those are going to be similar side effects you're going to see with that. So kind of increased sympathomimetic kind of effects, increased sympathetic nervous system. So agitation, insomnia, hallucinations, and then the orthostatic hypotension can be problematic for those patients as well, especially the older ones who kind of have less hemodynamic reserve. Rasagiline also is found to be useful. This one is not metabolized over to an amphetamine, so it probably has fewer adverse effects than you see with selegiline. But both of them, by decreasing the activity of monoamine oxidase B, they're going to be affecting other catecholamines than just dopamine. So they can also increase the activity of serotonin, which is why you can run the risk for serotonin syndrome. That's something we're going to talk more about in the behavioral section.
Would they receive the effects of the amphetamine?
Well, that's where they're getting some of those adverse effects from, right? So you're getting kind of those stimulatory kind of actions.
So why would it be is that supposed to be hypertension?
Orthostatic hypotension, right? So anytime you're kind of dysregulating catecholamine flow, because normally when you go from sitting to standing, mm-hmm. right, your body responds by sending out catecholamines to increase blood pressure, right, to increase that peripheral squeeze. If you've kind of dysregulated that and you're kind of just always sending out catecholamines due to this amphetamine effect, when you go to stand up, you may not have really those reserves to send out extra in order. So you kind of have this dysregulation where they're not really able to compensate as well. You think it'd always be high, but yes, well, this is not, you're not really getting like as amped up as you would see someone like, you know, snorted a bunch of Adderall or something, right? So this is something that's more mild, but it can still have effect for those patients who are more sensitive to it, like the older patients who have, you know, poor circulation already, you know, things like that. So again, they can either be used as monotherapy, probably in more mild Parkinson's disease, so kind of early on in the cases, or in earlier on in treatment. Some of the contraindications you'd worry about mixing this with are going to be other things that can increase serotonin activity. So we talked about some drugs like tramadol, anything like methadone can have some, has some effects there. Any other sympathomimetics or other stimulants, so amphetamines, ephedra, dextromethorphan even. Do you guys know what dextromethorphan is? Robitussin, yeah, so it's a cough suppressant, but that can have some kind of stimulatory activity. Obviously, any other monoamine oxidase inhibitors would be a bad thing to mix this with because that would have kind of increased activity, and so you'd have kind of too much catecholamine working there. And then also you can see some kind of synergistic activity, some anesthetics. So lots of drugs to be careful of mixing this with, but one of the biggest things dietary-wise is going to be we're looking for tyramine reactions, okay? So tyramine is something that's contained in certain types of foods in greater amounts than others. And basically tyramine gets broken down into things like serotonin, norepinephrine. And so if I have an inhibitor of that metabolism there, you can have too high an activity. And so this increases your risk for having things like serotonin syndrome or serotonin toxicity if you mix these together, right? So again, this is gonna be more pronounced with our non-specific monoamine oxidase inhibitors, which you'll see in the depression talks. But here, these are gonna still have some effect because they're interacting with that monoamine oxidase B and time. So again, basically I just say that think about all your favorite foods. They probably have a lot of tyramine in them, right? I know. So all of your aged cheeses, your aged meats, fava beans is one, so no Hannibal Lecters eating that stuff. Red wine, dark chocolate, all beer, all that kind of good stuff in life. I can't eat it. So again, this is probably why the monoamine oxidase inhibitors went by the wayside, because there's too many food and drug interactions there. But again, just a good patient education point to be careful of this. If they take a lot of these, ingest a lot of these foods along with these drugs, they can see some of these toxicities of, increased blood pressure, tachycardia, hallucinations, things like that. So good education point for them. Okay. So that's kind of the neuroprotective drugs. We'll talk a little bit more about the dopamine agonist a little bit later. But so for early uncomplicated PD, for symptomatic management, some of the early things we can use include anticholinergics, right? So by blocking the acetylcholine that's in excess, you kind of help to restore some of the kind of balance between dopamine and acetylcholine, kind of limit some of the side effects there, right? So this is good for patients who have tremor, but maybe they only have minimal hypokinesia, right? So maybe the tremor is really just kind of the main feature of their disease at this point. If they already have cognitive impairment, you do not want to give them an anticholinergic, because that can worsen that, right? Because we talked about anticholinergic toxicity, and what's one of the ones we see with that? Remember, blind as a bat, dry as a bone, mad as a hatter, right? So altered mental status is something you can see with these anticholinergics. Same thing can happen here. So if they already have kind of cognitive dysfunction, this might not be the best meds for them, okay? Other things you can see, a lot of drawing out of secretions, hallucinations. We mentioned all those side effects already, so you guys know what those look like. So the drugs you can see here are going to include benztropine, Cogentin, trihexphenidyl, Artane, and then also diphenhydramine or Benadryl, right? Benadryl we've seen before as being an H1 blocker, used a lot for allergic reactions, allergies, things like that. So, and again, when we look at patients who are having an acute dystonic reaction due to dopamine blockers, like Haldol or Haloperidol, when we get to the schizophrenia section, these are going to be the same drugs we use to treat that, because it's going to restore that balance between acetylcholine and dopamine, right? So, on a test question, if it came up to say, like, so-and-so patient, has just been diagnosed with Parkinson's disease, their main feature is just tremor, they have no cognitive impairment, which is going to be the best med to start for them? And you'd say, Cogentin might be the best for the drug, So, look at the symptoms and look to see what the drugs, specifically what they're going to be treating the symptoms. Amantadine or Simetrel is going to be another drug we can use for kind of early on in Parkinson's disease. This has kind of got an unclear mechanism of action. It's probably got kind of several things it's doing for these patients, including having some amphetamine-like activity to help release dopamine, right? So it can help to increase the amount of dopamine being released from the synapses. Has some anticholinergic effects, so we see a lot of how that can be beneficial. And can also have some NMDA antagonistic effects. So you guys remember what activates NMDA receptors? Glutamate, right? And glutamate we know is an excitatory neurotransmitter, which can help to induce excitotoxicity for these neurons. So maybe if you can block some of that glutamate activity, maybe you can help preserve some of those neurons for longer, right? So there may be some neuroprotective effect, but we're not really sure on that one. So again, can be used in monotherapy or in combination with some of these other drugs, okay? Actually, some other places you might see amantadine being used. We would use it in the ICU for patients who are having kind of prolonged coma. We'd actually use it for some of these patients to actually try to wake them up. For whatever reason, it kind of helped kind of reset the CNS and actually have them kind of wake up a little bit sooner than they would otherwise. But it does get eliminated through the kidney, so you do have to watch the renal function, because if this builds up and gets too high levels, you can see seizures associated with it, right? Obviously, you can see anticholinergic side effects along with this one as well, based on the mechanism. Okay. With a lot of these drugs, you're going to see tolerance develop over time, so you're going to see some decrease in effect go along with that. So this is why amantadine is more for kind of early disease, and it's going to kind of wear off its effects after a while and not going to be useful for the long run. Okay, so then we have our dopamine agonists. And again, some of these are thought to help kind of slow down the progression of disease because they're kind of taking the place of dopamine, kind of helping work as a kind of a replacement, right? So we're going to have some drugs that work on D1, D2, or D3 receptors. Those are kind of the primary receptors we're going to be looking at. And we'll talk about some drugs that are ergot derivatives and non-ergot derivatives. Does anyone know what an ergot is? Close. Not a plant, though. You want to take him out to parties because he's a real fun guy.
Fungus.
Yes, it's a fungus. Yes, it's a fungus. I'll talk about the ergot derivatives. But yeah, so ergots are based off of fungus. Then you'll see some drugs that are non-ergot derivatives. They don't really share kind of the chemical structure with those. These can also be used as first-line therapy. Again, better for kind of early-stage therapy, and they may be useful for helping to delay treatment with L-DOPA, right? So again, that's going to be one of the key features here is we'd like to keep patients off of levodopa, carbidopa as long as possible, because again, when you're given those drugs, you're going to wear out those neurons more quickly. So if we can help delay the need to start that drug, the better off we're going to be. So this is where these dopamine agonists kind of come into play. You can add it to L-DOPA, but you need to kind of reduce your dose somewhat because you can see over dopaminergic toxicity and end up seeing kind of more Huntington's almost signs where they have kind of too much movement going on. Okay. Other CNS or adverse effects you're going to be seeing here, mostly going to be CNS in nature. So you can see some somnolence, some confusion. The orthostatic hypotension, again, is going to be noted here, just very similar to the activities of those kind of amphetamine derivatives where they're kind of just dysregulating those catecholamines and how they're flowing can make it more difficult for patients kind of compensate when they're doing that change from sitting to standing. And also some thing you might see with some of these ergot derivatives is it actually causes retroperitoneal fibrosis and mitral valve regurgitation. It's kind of a unique side effect you can see with these. Also why you don't see a lot of use of these drugs, right? So ergot used to grow on rye, wheat. And so have you guys ever heard of St. Anthony's Fire? So St. Anthony's Fire is actually has some religious context, but basically back in the hundreds of years ago, back before we had any kind of modern medicine, people would eat this infected rye. They would make bread out of it and eat it, and they would have these effects from the fungus. And essentially what it causes is vasoconstriction due to binding to serotonin receptors and also some of these dopamine receptors. So it caused very severe vasoconstriction, especially in the tips of the fingers and the toes. So it would feel like you're on fire when you cause that vasoconstriction and having tissue necrosis. So some people would end up losing limbs due to gangrene. And so they call it St. Anthony's Fire, essentially, because the way they treated this was they thought they had some sort of curse on them or some sort of, you know, the devil put some sort of malady on them. So they said, we're going to go have this pilgrimage to St. Anthony's Cathedral, and we're going to pray there, and that's going to fix us. And so as they got away from the infected rye, they were starting to get better, because they weren't eating the same bread anymore. So by the time they got to St. Anthony's, they were all better, and they thought, this is great. And then they went back and probably got it again if they still ate the same bread. But that's where St. Anthony's Fire comes from, if you ever hear that. It's very interesting. But LSD comes from this fungus. And we also get a drug called bromocriptine. So this is an ergot derivative. Again, that vasoconstriction can be an issue here with some of these patients, especially if they get too much of it. Some non-ergot derivatives you'll see being used include pramipexole. This one does require some renal dosing, so renal patients, you might want to watch out for them. And you also see ropinirol and retigotine. Ropinirol is sometimes used for restless leg syndrome, so sometimes you might see it used in that case and help patients who have that restless leg. Okay. So, and then we have apomorphine, which is going to be kind of a ubiquitous dopamine receptor agonist. This is, again, a non-ergot derivative and not used clinically. This is that kind of one we use for more provocative tests. We can give patients this to see if they have a response to it, and that kind of gives us a sign whether or not they actually have Parkinson's or not, right? So you can give them these subcutaneous doses, and you kind of titrate the dose to see how they respond to it, and if they have kind of improvement of their symptoms, then chances are they probably have Parkinson's. You also will see with a lot of these dopamine agonists, it can cause a lot of nausea vomiting, because remember how what drugs do we use to prevent nausea vomiting? Buzofran, which blocks serotonin receptors. What else do we use? Phenergan. Phenergan does what? What does Phenergan do? It's antiemetic. How does it do it? It blocks dopamine receptors, right? Because we have dopamine receptors up in the chemoreceptor trigger zone. So by blocking those, you see antiemetic effects. And so if you imagine giving a dopamine agonist, you're going to expect to see nausea vomiting associated with it, right? That'll be important when we talk about some drug we use for migraines. So be aware of that. Monitor their blood pressure. because again, that's going to go up because you're going to have stimulatory actions on those dopamine neurons. Yes.
But these are only, like you said, used just to see if, like, to kind of diagnose.
Primarily, you will see some patients who are very severe. We'll talk about that kind of late stage disease and how you treat them. But you may need to use this kind of more long term. But generally, no. Generally, it's just going to be a more provocative test. Okay. You don't want to mix this with 5-HT3 antagonist because you can actually see some QT prolongation associated with that and some hypotension, so just be aware of that. So no mixing this with Zofran because that can actually end up worsening that, right? Okay, so kind of the gold standard for treating Parkinson's disease is levodopa-carbidopa. So it's a combination drugs, Sinemet is the brand name. And the levodopa is the active component. This is the actual business end of the molecule we're focused on. So this is a precursor to dopamine. It crosses the blood-brain barrier and gets converted to dopamine by this L amino acid decarboxylase in the striatum. Gets converted by that into dopamine, and it can have its normal activity, right? Normally, what you end up seeing is that the drug has a hard time making it to the blood-brain barrier if it's just given by itself. Okay, it ends up getting metabolized by a lot of kind of peripheral enzymes, things like catecholamine, methyltransferase, and monoamine oxidase. Will end up breaking it down before it has a chance to get to the brain. Also, when you give it by yourself, you see these kind of peripheral effects like nausea, vomiting, arrhythmias, things we don't like to see. So, what we do is we give it with a drug called carbidopa, which is kind of the kind of like a beta lactamase. Inhibitor, right? You guys remember that from the anti-infectives, right? So again, when we're given something like Zosyn, the piperacillin is the business end. That's the thing that's actually killing the bacteria. The tazobactam is used to block beta-lactamase. This kind of same thing is happening here where the carbidopa does not cross the blood-brain barrier, but inhibits peripheral LAAD. So it prevents the peripheral breakdown of that levodopa and allows the levodopa to get to the brain to have its activity, okay? Also helps to reduce a lot of those peripheral side effects as well. So we're going to see that the pharmacokinetics can be altered pretty significantly. So one of the things that you look at is that normally it gets metabolized or gets absorbed through the duodenum, and actually it competes with other amino acids for absorption. So what kind of diet do you think would end up inhibiting absorption? Yeah, high protein. So one of the things we'll see is that if you're not having good activity of L-DOPA is actually you space it out from mealtime with meats or high protein foods and things like that. So that's one of the things that can kind of help us make sure we're absorbing enough of the drug. Okay. So it's going to cross the blood-brain barrier, and that can also be have a saturable kind of diffusion where, again, if you're kind of overloading it with too much drug, you can kind of saturate all those transporters, so that may take time for it to cross over. And you can see here that the half-life is going to be increased as you add on enzyme inhibitors. So we'll talk about entacapone a little bit later as an enzyme inhibitor, but carbidopa is going to be the main one we're looking at here as helping to increase that half-life. Okay. Also, it's a fairly short half-life. So what do you think that means as far as how often you have to give the drug? You may need to give it very frequently, or you have to give extended release preparations. That can be the other thing you can do to get around that. So you may be able to use this early on as initial therapy, but usually it's going to be kind of relegated to when other things have started to fail. Okay, because when you give all this L-DOPA in the CNS and it's being converted to dopamine in the blood, or once it's crossed the blood-brain barrier, it starts to stress out those neurons and starts to produce more of that those reactive oxygen species, right? So that's going to help to degrade those neurons more quickly. So that's why we like to hold off on these. But it is the most effective treatment for PD, right? Because we're giving more dopamine, essentially. You're giving more precursor for the patient to make their own dopamine. So eventually all patients are going to require treatment with this. That's why we like to hold off on it if we can. Side effects are going to be similar to the other kind of dopamine agonists. You're going to see the nausea, vomiting. You can end up seeing some dyskinesia related to kind of adding on the dopamine activity, hallucinations, insomnia, somnolence. Depression can be another problem. And then obviously the orthostatic hypotension is going to pop up here again. So as I mentioned, Sinemet is the brand name for this one. It's probably the most common one. I see being given, you know, three times a day, so fairly frequently you're having to give there. And you're titrating the dose to how well they can tolerate it, right? So you're basing it off of the symptoms and also kind of adverse effects that are developing from the drug itself. So generally start low, go slow, okay? They have controlled release preparations as well that kind of helps you to give it less frequently. And this one you want to dose, you want to try and kind of change the dose every 3 days or so until they kind of get to a set point where they're having good symptom relief and they're also not having too many side effects. Okay. So again, it's all about titration. Again, this drug works pretty quickly, right? As soon as it gets into the blood-brain barrier, you start to make more dopamine, it's going to start working. So it's not like it takes 6 weeks or so to really start to see effects from this. Also, we mentioned some patients are going to have problems with even things like swallowing. So for those kind of more progressive patients, you even have an oral disintegrating tablet they can use to kind of help them get the drug in the system a little bit easier. So, again, there's controversy about kind of the initial choice of therapy. They would say that, you know, dopamine metabolism may create free radicals. So again, that's where I mentioned that before. And then also you're going to see dyskinesia as being more common with levodopa. So I'll talk about those in a little bit. But essentially, by having too much dopamine activity, you kind of enhance this kind of Huntington-like effect. So you can see some dyskinesias there where they actually have too much movement going on. It's too easy to initiate movement, I should say. But we know that L-DOPA is going to reduce mortality for patients with Parkinson's disease in the long run. But if we can use the dopamine agonists and monoamine oxidase B inhibitors, hopefully we can use those for kind of short-term neuroprotection and then switch them over to the L-DOPA. But again, it's all depending on how your patient responds. If they're kind of failing everything else, then L-DOPA is going to have to be the thing they go with. Okay. Another drug we can use to enhance the effects of the dopamine we have produced is going to be a COM-T inhibitor. So this is where entacapone comes in. So again, by inhibiting that peripheral catecholamine O-methyl transferase, or COM-T, it increases the half-life of the L-DOPA. Right? So we can give this to not only prolong the effects of the dopamine our CNS is already producing, but they can help to increase the half-life of that L-DOPA. Again, you want to decrease your L-DOPA dose when you add this on because it's going to be lasting around for longer, so you can increase your risk for side effects by doing that, okay? And then whenever you take this drug off, you generally want to taper off the dose because, again, you want to make sure you're not giving them any kind of sudden changes in the amount of dopamine that's available to them, okay? You do not want to mix these with the monoamine oxidase A inhibitor. So those would be this kind of older antidepressants. So we'll talk about those when we get to behavioral, but you're not going to have too many patients to run into this because it's just not a common drug class that's being used anymore, okay? And really just the side effects are going to be related back to overactivity of the L-DOPA, but also it can turn urine kind of brown or orange coloring, right? Because normally when you see brown urine, what are you thinking? You think rhabdo and you think, oh, that's not good. But warn your patients about it. You know, anytime you're changing the color of their pee or their poop, let them know, because otherwise they could be real worried. Okay, so we said entacapone is one of these drugs that will do this, and also tolcapone. This one doesn't use very frequently due to black box warnings for hepatotoxicity, so really entacapone is the main kind of go-to drug for this one. Okay, there's even a combination of all three of them called Stalevo. So, how would you treat these patients? So again, this is kind of what I've been talking about kind of the whole time. So early on, so say you have your diagnosis of Parkinson's, you know, look for the presence of symptoms of impairment, right? So if you can manage any kind of non-motor symptoms, again, that's not something the drugs are going to be super useful for kind of early on, but you know, this is where a lot of, you know, non-pharmacologic therapy is going to be useful. If they're not really having the significant impairment, we can give rasagiline, which we said is what type of drug? Rasagiline. What type of drug do we say that was? Yeah, it's MAOB inhibitor, right? So it's kind of early on in therapy, you use the MAOB inhibitor, thought to somewhat be neuroprotective, so that's kind of good for early on to help with that mild disease, right? So if they're having tremor, then what do you want to consider? Yeah, you want to consider anticholinergic. Notice that you probably don't want to use that necessarily for older patients because you worry about the CNS effects, right? You worry about having them having worsened dementia and things like that, right? So that's where you kind of look at your age range. And again, I'm not going to say you have a 66-year-old patient with tremor. I'm not going to make it that granular, but just look at the symptomatology. Look at kind of the age of the patient. Like, you know, are they, you know, if I would make it pretty clear and say something like, you know, they're already having, you know, signs of dementia, you know, decide whether or not to give them anticholinergic, and you say, no, I probably wouldn't give it to them for those patients, right? So I'll be pretty clear on that kind of stuff. But for those patients who are older, who you don't want to give an anticholinergic to, that's when you need to start to consider using the Sinemet, okay? If the anticholinergic is not being useful, then you should, again, go to Sinemet. So you'll see that ultimately all of this kind of goes back to Sinemet, okay? If they were not having tremor and they're just having kind of bradykinesia or rigidity or kind of those kind of more cardinal signs of Parkinson's, that's where you need to consider either a dopamine agonist, like, you know, the ropinirole or the promexipol, or you can just consider using the carbidopa-levodopa if that wasn't working, okay? So, basically, that's how the kind of the management is going to go for those patients. Again, it's just kind of a stepwise process, seeing how those early drugs are working. If it's not working for them, then again, kind of progressing back to the Sinemet. So what you end up seeing, though, with the progression of pharmacotherapy for these patients is that early on, you can use monotherapy, right? So if they just are having tremor, or if they're just having some, you know, postural instability, things like that, you can get away with one drug for them, right? Later on, you're going to start to add on more drugs in order to help kind of enhance the effects of either the early ones you used to have on board, or you're starting to add on more dopamine-type agonist or levodopa, carbidopa. You know, this is when you start to get to the polytherapy. Eventually, you're going to start to see, as you wear out more and more of those neurons, those other drugs are going to be less effective, and you're eventually going to go back to monotherapy in the very late stages, right? And so that monotherapy is primarily just going to consist of the levodopa, carbidopa, okay? Yes? Nope, this would be like starting out with a monoamine oxidase B inhibitor, or starting off with, Cogentin or bentropine. You're starting off with the monotherapy. Eventually, you're going to progress to multiple drugs. That's just kind of how it naturally goes. And then eventually, all the other ones are not going to be super effective, and so you're just going to go back to the Sinemet. Okay?
Because you wouldn't ever put, like, the L-DOPA with an MAA.
You have to be careful when you do those kind of combinations. You usually have to drop your dose of the levodopa because you worry about kind of enhancing the effects of it, right? So essentially, it's like increasing the levels of the L-DOPA that you were giving because of the fact that it's being inhibited from being metabolized. Yep. So again, go back to the slide. You'll see where it says, you know, to watch out. Normally, you don't want to mix like a COMT inhibitor plus a monoamine oxidase inhibitor because you might have just too much activity there with the dopamine. But usually, one or the other is okay with adding with L-DOPA. Just had to watch your dose. So, again, we'll talk about this levodopa honeymoon a little bit, but usually when, you know, when you have these patients that are on kind of monotherapy or on one or two drugs, you know, as their symptoms get worse and worse, you'll eventually put them on Sinemet, and all of a sudden everything just, like, it's great, right? Like, all the symptoms kind of go away because we know this is kind of the gold standard therapy, and it's the most effective for them. We call this the honeymoon because they start to feel way, way better. But again, we know this is putting more oxidative stress on the neurons. Eventually, this honeymoon phase is going to go away, and the disease is eventually going to progress on, right? Because again, we're not slowing the disease. We're only fixing the symptoms at this point. So unless you guys want to come up with, like, a miracle cure for it, anyone? No? Okay. So, yeah, so this is normally the way it's going to go. Okay, so we're going to talk about some of these different kind of late complications of Parkinson's. You're going to have some motor fluctuations you can see here where you can have the drug either wearing off too early. You could have the drug not kind of coming on early enough, so you might have delayed onset of action. And some of this predictable kind of on-off for some patients, kind of a mixture of the two there. Then we'll talk about this refreezing, refractory symptoms that can occur. That's a kind of that catatonia they have when they basically just have an ultimate depletion of their dopamine. We'll see how to treat that in a little bit. You also see if your levels of dopamine get too high, you can end up having these dyskinesias. So we'll talk about what that is, but basically a lot of it's related back to the peak dose that you get. And I'll show you some graphs on how that progresses as time goes on. And then things like dysarthria, dysphagia, those are really refractory symptoms. This is where you need to start considering things like apomorphine, surgery needs to be considered, levodopa oral solutions, which can be given via things like G-tubes. So if they can't swallow anything, sometimes they have G-tubes placed just to administer the meds. So this is kind of more progressive disease. So when you're looking at the motor complications of this, it's important to kind of remember these graphs. So basically what you have here is that you'll have your drug levels of L-DOPA, right? So, you know, after you take a normal oral dose, you see it kind of peak up, and then it's going to naturally degrade off. You have the response threshold. So once you get your levels high enough, this is where you start to see the initial response for the drug, right? So this is where they have their symptoms start to improve. And you also have this dyskinesia threshold. Okay, so again, this is going to be unwanted or kind of involuntary movements that are coming about from having too much dopamine activity. Notice here that your margin for error is pretty wide here early on in therapy. Okay, so you can give them plenty of L-DOPA, and they're really never going to hit that dyskinesia threshold. Okay, as time goes on, as they get more progressively worse, you're going to notice that the duration of therapy or duration of response is going to get worse because that kind of threshold has started to go up somewhat for response. And then also your threshold for having the dyskinesias is starting to decrease as well. So your margins are starting to get smaller and smaller, essentially. Okay, so that means you're going to have a shorter duration of response. So notice your area under the curve for actually being above the clinical effect is getting smaller, right? So it means the drug's not going to be effective for as long. Increased risk for dyskinesias and just a lower threshold in general for having those, right? And then finally, at the very, very late disease, you're going to see this is where you have, in order just to get any kind of effect, you have to really give doses that are going to hit that dyskinesia threshold pretty easily. So very short duration of response, high dyskinesia risk, and just a really narrow therapeutic window where the drug's going to be effective. And so we'll talk about some ways we can combat that with how we administer the drug or what we're giving them, and I'll go ahead and do that after a 10-minute break. So giving you something to mull over in your mind as you go to the bathroom. Any questions from the first hour? Oh, okay. So yeah, you have look like you had a face like you had a question.
No.
Okay. Yeah. Good. I'll talk louder. No. All right. So for the motor complications, we're talking about ways that we can get around some of those. So if you're wearing off, meaning you are having kind of early discontinuation of the action of the drug, so kind of wearing off too soon, this is oftentimes related to loss of those presynaptic neurons. So again, this is all disease progression occurring here. Some of the ways you can help to increase that duration of action is one to add entacapone, right? We said that is what type of drug?
The one you're not supposed to take.
You can take it. The dopamine was the one you didn't want. So it's a COMT inhibitor, right? So it's inhibiting the metabolism of the L-DOPA, right? So that helps us to stick around for longer. So that could be one thing we could do. Also adding on a dopamine agonist just to have some more dopaminergic effects. That can be useful as well. And then you can also look at adding on Sinemet more frequently. So this is where you can see some patients being on like 6 to 8 times a day, which can be pretty difficult to keep up with for a lot of patients, especially if they're not taking care of themselves. They have like another caregiver, you know, they have their own concerns and whatnot. Other things you can do include making like an oral solution that may help to actually aid absorption. You can do that. You can add a monoamine oxidase B inhibitor. These are all things that either help increase blood levels of the L-DOPA or help it to stay around for a little bit longer. Okay. Switching over to Sinemet CR might be a little bit better option as well because that allows for more. You don't really have such a peak effect, especially with those dyskinesias. It's kind of more of a kind of nice plateau, so it may allow for a kind of more long duration of action there. Okay. Here you can also see things like apomorphine injections or even duodenal levodopa infusions. This is for more very severe type of patients you'd be dealing with there, right? Yes. Controlled release, right? So just an extended release kind of preparation. For that off dystonia, where basically they're having kind of inhibited movements due to the drug wearing off too early, you can do things like adding bedtime doses of Sinemet CR that'll kind of help them, especially if they're having like kind of early morning symptoms. Add things like dopamine agonist, reticotine could be another one added on here. Sinemet upon rising in the morning can help with this as well, especially if the overnight dose is not helping too much. And then for some of these off dystonias, you can actually give botulinum toxin. Because nowhere else do you see that being used?
In the face.
In the face, right? Tension headaches. Yeah, I mean, tension headaches, yeah, that's a good one. We'll talk about that later. But essentially, it's a paralytic. It kind of prevents release of acetylcholine from neurons. So you can actually inject that into certain spastic muscles and will help to help release some of that spasticity, right? Also, you can take the extra and just inject it yourself and look beautiful. And just kidding, don't do that. It's bad. And again, very similar things you can do if you have like an unpredictable on-off, right? So looking at using different dopamine agonists, using inhibitors of those enzymes like monoamine oxidase B or COMT. Here's an interesting one where you can actually try to redistribute the protein around their diet. So if you can kind of avoid having a lot of amino acids intaking in one meal and then give the levodopa around that time, that can be useful to kind of help limit some of that saturable absorption you have there in the stomach or in the small intestine afterwards, right? And again, you can see continuous infusions of levodopa might be need to use in some really severe patients. So if they're having a delayed onset for action, so it's taking longer than you expect for the drug to really start to kick in for your patients, you can use things like, you can look for medication interactions. Maybe something is there to make the levodopa being metabolized more quickly, or maybe it is something is antagonizing the effects there. Here is where reducing protein in the diet can be useful. Even increasing things like fiber or laxatives can make them a little bit more regular and absorb the drug a little bit more consistently. Discontinuing anticholinergic may be useful because we mentioned anticholinergics slow down the GI tract, so that can actually help slow the absorption of some of that levodopa, so that would be one thing to look at. And then again, looking at separating the Sinemet from the actual protein in the meal. So either 1 hour before or 2 hours after, that can be useful as well. Okay, so lots of different options here. To try. Again, they're getting more and more severe as things goes on and as the disease gets more progressive. So again, if they're having this kind of peak dose on effect, that's where they're getting their levels too high and having a dystonia related to that or dyskinesia. You can basically try to lower your cenemet dose. So try lowering the levodopa they have there. And then if you have any inhibitors on board, discontinue those because that's obviously helping to raise your levels as well. Okay. To try to help compensate for that, you can add on like a dopamine agonist or use something like amantadine. These can also be useful. And even some drugs like clozapine, which we'll talk about more in the behavioral section, but also propranolol, which is what type of drug. It's a beta blocker. It can be useful to kind of block some of those kind of skeletal muscle effects. That could be useful. And for some patients, you may get this kind of biphasic dyskinesia that can occur. If you can shorten the dosing interval, it will help to produce kind of overlapping effects. It kind of helps to kind of normalize out the levels that they're having there. So just giving the drug more frequently at maybe a smaller doses, and then either adding on a dopamine agonist or switching over to a controlled release format, right? So all these things are kind of used to kind of tune up their regimen a little bit just to make sure that the drug is kind of coming on effectively, it's lasting for as long as possible, and you don't really run into those dyskinesias, okay? So again, this is just kind of an idea of what it looks like when you have these peak dose dyskinesias and the diphasic dyskinesias, right? So again, when you're having too high a dose is where you have a dyskinesia occur, and then you're also having kind of the opposite effect. It's kind of hypokinesias occur when the levels start to wear off, right? So as I take a dose, drug starts to kick in, have the kind of peak phase effect, and then as it starts to wear off, you're going to have hypokinesia until you take the next dose. And so in order to avoid that, if you were to give the drug more frequently, these curves start to overlap a little bit and you have kind of a longer time. You're just spending here in the kind of the sweet spot, so to speak, right? Okay, so the things you're monitoring for, look at like drug administration times, look around meal times to see if they're absorbing it appropriately. Especially with some of these more complicated drug regimens, look for drug interactions that could be affecting them, especially if they have other comorbid conditions that are interacting as well. Kind of have a good diary of those kind of effects that they're having so you can kind of diagnose them and figure out where it is in the drug therapy that are going wrong. You're looking for adverse effects. Obviously, non-adherence is going to be a big thing, especially with more kind of complicated regimens or if they're, I can't even remember to take like a multivitamin once a day, like having to take a drug 6 to 8 times a day, like that would be almost impossible, I'm sure. So look at non-adherence, assess their quality of life as time goes on, and just kind of screen for those kind of non-motor complications as well. Yes?
Quality
of life. Little O, big O. Okay, so any questions on Parkinson's?
It's been a long day, guys.
Very long day, absolutely. Okay, so next we're going to go into multiple sclerosis. This is actually a brand new section I've added in just for this year. You're welcome, yeah. It's important, though. There's lots of new drugs we haven't talked about before that will be seen in here. So anyway, what is MS? Have you guys covered MS before?
It's a demyelinating disorder.
Hmm? Yeah, it's a demyelinating disorder. So it's an inflammatory disease of the CNS that eventually is going to lead to these kind of plaques, these sclerosed areas of the nerves where they've been demyelinated. What does myelin normally do for the neurons? Right, so it insulates, right? It has little different portions of it that are being insulated, and so the action potential kind of jump from point to point, right? Those nodes of Ranvier, or whatever they're called. You guys remember that from anatomy, probably. Right, so it helps to speed along the action potential. So obviously, if you were to start to demyelinate those, that's going to kind of mess up the action potentials, and so you're going to see a lot of neurologic issues related to this, okay? So most of it is related to kind of an inappropriate autoimmune response. It's kind of similar to what we're going to see with our rheumatoid conditions, right? So the body can't really differentiate itself from foreign, and so it's going to start to attack itself. And so here specifically, it's attacking the myelin sheath on these neurons in the spinal cord, okay? And again, just because you have all this kind of proliferation of these neutrophils and other white cells that are coming to the neurons, causing this damage. And again, a lot of times this is irreversible. Okay, so this is why, again, this is going to be seen as a progressive disease. And some of the drugs we're going to use help to kind of limit that progression and help slow down the disease state, right? Because this can be very debilitating for a lot of patients. Very, very difficult to especially catch because, again, a lot of times early on, it's nonspecific, so it can be hard to diagnose. So the earlier we can get drugs on board to help kind of slow down progression, the better off we're going to be. So three main phases of treatment for MS is going to be, one, we would like to do treatments of exacerbations. So again, if they have an acute flare-up, this is going to be good to help shorten the duration and kind of lessen the severities of attacks. We're going to have our DMTs, or disease-modifying therapy. These are kind of analogous to our DMARDs that we talked about with rheumatoid arthritis, right? So these help to alter the course of illness and diminish that progressive disability over time. And then we'll look at symptomatic therapies to help kind of maintain their quality of life. Okay. Pain is going to be a big kind of side effect from a lot of this. And this is where you see a lot of patients kind of, you know, especially because of the nonspecific kind of nature of the disease, a lot of people may claim to have MS and use it as a reason to get meds. So again, this would be very difficult to actually diagnose these patients and try to discern them from just pain seeking or, you know, medication seeking patients. So this can be one of those kind of traps you fall into, especially, you know, if you're working like in the ER and places like that where, you know, patients come along, and, oh, my MS is flaring up. And, it's, you know, it's not like there's a ton of like actual tests you can run to say, yes, you have MS or not, you know. So it'd be very difficult to manage some of these patients, especially if they have nefarious purposes. I'm just cynical, though. I'm just coming from the ER, so I just assume everyone's seeking meds, right? Yeah. You're not like that, though. Keep your innocence as long as possible. anywho, so moving on. So for these exacerbations, similar to how we treat exacerbations for rheumatoid arthritis, what do we use? Corticosteroid, right? Hit that inflammation from the top of the pyramid all the way down, right? So oftentimes you'll give them IV doses of things like methylprednisolone. Normally they're going to be, you know, especially for severe exacerbations, maybe coming in patient for a stay. And so they may need like 3 to 10 days worth of IV methylprednisolone. This is really thought to help limit the amount of edema at the area of demyelination. So that can help to decrease the actual destruction that's occurring and decrease a lot of the symptoms you're seeing along with that. Okay. So if you can start within 2 weeks of symptom onset before kind of more progressive damage is being done, and you generally are going to see improvement in symptoms around 3 to 5 days or so. Okay. Now, if I treated a patient with 10 days of methylprednisolone, would I need to taper them off?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. So you definitely want to taper them because we worry about adrenal insufficiency. Absolutely. So that would be one thing you want to worry about. So again, obviously same side effects you're going to see with any of the corticosteroids, the sleep disturbances, worsens glycemic control, mood alteration, you know, all those things you can see there. And even for some really severe patients, it may even actually have plasma exchange to help get rid of a lot of those inflammatory cytokines and get rid of some of those kind of inflammatory cells. So that might be used in some rare cases. So, and then looking at our disease modifying therapy. So this is going to be, you know, basically we're basing these therapies on the clinical predictors of how severe the disease may become. And then we're also kind of basing the therapy we're using now on the safety and tolerability of current therapies. And so this has kind of changed quite a bit in the past few years, because now we actually have some oral agents that are going to be good to use for kind of more long-term management of these patients. We're going to see that there were some kind of bad options we had kind of early on that we actually still end up using in some cases. But our first generation agents that we had decreased the relapse rate, which is good, and helped to decrease some of these white matter lesions that you can see on CT after long periods of time, you know, with more progressive disease. They don't really take effect immediately, so similar to what you saw your DMARDs, right? They took time to work, right? It takes time to really kind of tamp down that immune system. And so, you know, it takes 1 to 2 years of therapy for efficacy to really be noted in a lot of these cases. So, right, so you need to treat them for a while before they really start to see effects. So you need to make sure that they are using their symptomatic management appropriately to help kind of manage quality of life, and that way they don't have a relapse too early. Okay, you're going to see that the second generation agents that we have are approved for more progressive or worsening MS, and all of them are very, very expensive. You may see anywhere between, like, say, $70,000 a year, $200,000 a year. Like, these are expensive drugs, right? Especially these monoclonal antibodies we're going to be talking about. Okay. So the first group of drugs that we're using for a long time were these interferons, right? So interferons are naturally occurring cytokines that our body produces. We don't know their full mechanism, but they're thought to be kind of immunomodulatory, which is just a fancy way of saying we don't know how it works on the immune system. But it's thought to affect our suppressor cell function. So maybe by inhibiting that, you're able to kind of tamp down the immune system and kind of help to not attack itself so much and kind of help the neurons out. Okay, there's a couple different varieties you can see here. Here's the brand names in that second column. So interferon beta 1A, beta 1B. Don't get too caught up on this. Just, you know, realize they're interferons. And that they are, some will be listed as kind of low potency versus high potency. That's just going to be related back to their side effects. And we'll talk about those in just a minute.
Are these first generation?
These are going to be our first generation drugs. Yep. Then you can see anywhere, you know, $157,000 a year for the pegylated interferon. Pegylated interferon has kind of largely supplanted a lot of the other types of interferon. Basically, they've added on a polyethylene glycol group to it, and it kind of limits the amount of side effects you see with those. So if you ever see pegylated interferon or PEG interferon, that's what that's referring to. Okay, generally more expensive, but it's less side effects you can see with that. So what type of adverse effects are we thinking about? So we can have hepatotoxicity. So of course you want to monitor at baseline to see how that's developing over time. Make sure you don't have any increases in your LFTs. Because of its immunosuppression, you can see CBC changes, so monitor for that. And then also very frequently, you're going to see a lot of flu-like symptoms along with the injections of these drugs. Because they're foreign proteins, they need to be injected. You can see some you know, hypersensitivity to that. So you get those flu-like myalgias and fever and things like that you can see with it. Some patients have menstrual irregularities. And one of the other big things you see is it's depression. So interferons also get a lot of use, or they used to, for hep C. And you see a lot of psychiatric changes with that. So again, patients who have kind of unchecked depression, suicidal tendencies, like this is going to be worsened by drugs like interferon. Okay. Another drug that we had available, this is kind of, again, a first generation agent. This is a polypeptide called Gladomer. Basically, it was a combination of this L-alanine, glutamic acid, lysine, and tyrosine. That's not the important point to note, but what is important is it actually will mimic this antigenic property of this myelin basic protein. So this is a protein that the body has learned to sense as a foreign thing and needs to attack, right? So by mimicking that protein, it's able to kind of bind to these T cells and actually prevent them from being activated in the first place. So by doing that, it inhibits that T cell activation, inhibits the inflammation, okay? So that's how this drug's really working. So again, it's another injectable product. So again, because it's a foreign kind of protein, it has to be injected, can't be taken orally. Right? But you will see some injection site reactions along with that. And then about 10% of patients have this like chest tightness, flushing, dyspnea associated with it in the last about 20 minutes, right? So pretty uncomfortable. Can certainly happen to any dose for these patients. It's not something that goes away necessarily. So they're just always at risk for having this kind of happen. Because, you know, again, when I think about, you know, chest tightness, flushing, and dyspnea, what are you thinking? I think a heart attack, right? So they may feel like they're having a heart attack, but just let them know that, hey, this is just a side effect of the drug. Okay. Now, some of the newer agents, we have these monoclonal antibodies. This is natalizumab. So this is actually a monoclonal antibody against this very late antigen. I'm not sure who names these proteins, but they named one a very late antigen. I don't know if there's a very early antigen, but this one's a very late antigen, or VLA1. And so it blocks this interaction. So again, it's a monoclonal antibody, so it's targeted against a specific molecule. So the VLA1, so it binds that up and will basically the CNS vascular cell adhesion molecule prevents these two molecules from interacting with one another. So by doing that, it actually prevents lymphocytes from crossing the blood-brain barrier. So if they're kept out in the periphery, can't cross them to the CNS, can't get to the spinal cord to interact with these neurons. Okay, so preventing the neutrophils from getting to their site of action. So there is risk associated with it. So you guys remember the REMS programs I talked about? What are those? Yeah, it's like for Accutane, right? So they're special programs. So if the FDA recognizes that there's a particular risk with a drug, so for instance, teratogenicity with Accutane, they will put in these risk evaluation and mitigation strategies. Okay, so this one has one as well for concerns about this multifocal leukoencephalopathy. So it's a black box warning for this one, something they have to monitor for specifically, and you have to be, you know, monitored, or you have to be registered with the program. Provider, pharmacy usually has to all be registered with this in order to make sure the patient does not have this develop over time. So careful monitoring associated with that, okay? You can also see some hepatotoxicity here, some depression worsening. Again, don't know the full mechanism of why that is. You know, things like interferon doesn't make sense why that would, you know, change mood, but it just happens to do that. So I can't really give you a good reason for that one. Next, we had this fingolimod. This is one of the ones that was kind of revolutionary for the treatment of MS, because this is the first oral disease-modifying therapy for MS, right? So this is a big deal for these, because, again, before they either had to go to an infusion center to have these drugs infused, or they had to self-inject themselves. So anytime you can switch over to oral therapy, it's going to be a big deal. You see the same thing happen with hep C as well when we get to that next week. This one is working to agonize the sphingosine 1-phosphate receptor. Basically what that does is it's going to sequester these lymphocytes that are circulating into lymphoid organs and basically prevents them from getting to the CNS. So similar to what we saw in the last slide, this is just doing it via a different mechanism. Okay, so sequesters the white cells, prevents them from getting to the CNS. So big side effects you're going to see with this, you can see bradycardia, especially with the first dose. This will dissipate over time. So this is one of those things where you actually want to give it to them in clinic and watch them for the first 6 hours or so to see how they respond to it. If they don't develop that bradycardia, then generally they're going to be pretty okay. Okay. You can see lymphoma start to develop. But this is reversible. That makes sense, though, because, again, if you're sequestering those white cells in the lymph glands, like, of course, you're going to have a lymphoma develop there. So, again, once you take that away, though, it should be reversible. You also can see risk for infections, similar to other types of disease-modifying therapy we've seen before, and hepatotoxicity. This one's another one where you do not want to give live vaccines along with this because you worry about? Work about activation of the disease, right? So no live vaccines. You want to get this one beforehand or after discontinuation of therapy. And then we have teriflunomide. This one is going to be oral as well. So again, this is another one of those kind of new second generation agents that are kind of changing the way we treat MS. This one is working on this dihydroorotate dehydrogenase. And so what that does is it prevents these proliferation of B cells and will inhibit the number of inflammatory cells that get to the CNS, right? So it kind of helps kind of earlier along in the process to prevent that kind of proliferation of a lot of the inflammatory cells. Interestingly enough, this is one actually has a metabolite of leflunomide, so it actually gets broken down into a drug we've seen before as disease-modifying therapy. Big interactions to worry about is if they're on warfarin, you're going to see a big jump in their INR, about 25%, so that would be one thing you definitely want to monitor for. And then some other kind of random side effects like transaminitis, so you can see increases in their LFTs, alopecia, paresthesias. Big thing to note though is going to be this black box warning for both hepatotoxicity and teratogenicity. The interesting thing with this drug is that it actually sticks around in the blood for up to 2 years after discontinuation. So that means that whole time, and again, which kind of patients are more likely to be affected by MS? Females, absolutely. So females, again, they're taking these meds, it could be sticking around for a long time. So anytime during that period where they get pregnant, they can have this drug still around. So what they actually recommend is one, obviously use prophylaxis if they are, you know, still on the medication. But then also the other thing would be to actually use a cholestyramine washout. So you guys remember the drug cholestyramine? Mm-hmm. What was that? It's a bile acid question. So the idea would be that it would kind of help bind up the drug as it, you know, kind of goes from area of high concentration in the blood to low concentration in the GI tract, can bind it up, and then you just would defecate it out. Okay, so it's recommended to help draw those levels down more quickly. So this one is another one you want to make sure you're testing for TB beforehand, so you don't have activation of a latent infection. And then one last one is dimethyl fumarate. This one, we don't know the mechanism for, also as an oral agent, it's available. Here you can see just some random side effects like flushing, increased LFTs and whatnot. So not a whole lot of information on that one's available. Then we have alemtuzumab. This is another monoclonal antibody. This obviously would not be an oral agent, right? Because monoclonal antibodies have to be injected. But this one is targeted against CD52. And actually causes cytolysis, or kind of the breakdown of these cells that express that CD antigen or CD52 receptor. So T and B cells, macrophages, all may be affected by this. You're going to see that a lot of patients are going to develop an infusion reaction along with this. So generally, this is not kind of like a go-to medication. It's usually kind of more kind of second or third line. You do see risk for increased risk for infections, so both respiratory, urinary tract infections, you know, herpes simplex virus. So they actually recommend prophylactic acyclovir for kind of high risk patients, and then TB activation as well. Okay. So also a lot of patients also will develop this autoimmune disease as well. So again, another reason why we don't use this one too often, but you can see you know, issues with the thyroid. Actually, some patients may develop type 1 diabetes, glomerulonephritis, hemolytic anemia. Again, so lots of reasons why not to use this drug unless they're really refractory to lots of other stuff. Okay. Okay, so so the disease-modifying therapies, these are going to be for patients with poor prognostic factors, or if they have a, you know, kind of a clinical presentation of MS. They can use that natalizumab, that fingolimod, the teriflunomide, or the dimethyl fumarate. They can use this for kind of induction therapy, right, to help kind of control their symptoms. You're going to see that the efficacy and safety is going to vary pretty widely between patients, and especially, you know, different side effects manifesting at different times for those patients. So again, it's going to be patient preference for, you know, what type of route of administration is okay for them, you know, what kind of insurance coverage do they have, like what is actually going to be covered by their insurance, you know, things like that. A lot of these newer meds may not be covered by some insurances, so kind of have to all take into consideration when deciding how to treat your patients. For symptomatic management, we know they have a lot of pain issues that come about with MS. So for some of the spasticity of the muscles, we can use muscle relaxants. So things like baclofen, cyclobenzaprine. We talked about those before. Do you guys remember how they work? Yeah, they work on the GABA B receptor to increase activity, right? So what do you think is the main side effect you're going to see with those drugs? Drowsiness, sedation, nystagmus, things like that. So CNS depression effects. Gabapentin or pregabalin could be used here as well. We'll talk about more of those when we get to the we already talked about those. Yeah, so gabapentin, pregabalin. I'm sorry, I have too many classes going on right now, so I forget who I've talked to already. It's like juggling multiple girlfriends or something. I would never do that, though. Just FYI. No, I was too nerdy to ever have more than a girlfriend. I'm very lucky to even be married right now, I'll tell you what. But anyway, so gabapentin, pregabalin, those are both can be useful for more of those neuropathic pains, can help out with some of that spasticity. And then onobotulinum toxin A or the Botox can be useful here as well if you have really bad spasticity. With the bladder, they can have bladder issues. They have kind of a lot of incontinence associated with that. So oxybutynin, sulfonylureas, and darafin. So we talked about those as anticholinergic drugs that kind of help you to hold on to the urine a little bit better, helps to relax those detrusor muscles. Remember that from the urology section last semester? You know, trade names only? Well, I know both. Okay, and then self-catheterization could be useful for some patients as well. Obviously, you want to try the medications first if that jives with them. You'll see for some of these sensory symptoms they can have, that things like tricyclic antidepressants, phenytoin, carbamazepine, all may be useful for these. And then for some fatigue, you may use things like amphetamines, amantadine, which we mentioned back in the Parkinson's section. Antidepressants can sometimes be useful. So kind of you're trying lots of different things to see kind of what works for your patient. It may not all be, there's not going to be one golden bullet or silver bullet that works kind of for everything for them. So you may need to kind of play around with their meds to see what works best for them. Modafinil or armodafinil are two different drugs that we will sometimes use for patients who have kind of sleep-wake issues. It's a lot of patients who have like kind of shift work sleep issues, that they work overnight and have issues getting to sleep. This kind of helps reset their sleep cycle. So sometimes you'll see those drugs being used there. I'm trying to remember the brand names for those off the top of my head. Provigil and Nuvigil are those two. So you ever hear those? I know like my sister, she was a ER nurse for a long time, and so she worked overnights, and I think she still continues to work overnights as a nurse practitioner, but she had issues getting on a regular sleep cycle when she came off of her shifts, and so she used those medications to kind of help reset yourself. But anyway. So any questions on MS section? All right, so moving on. Something you guys have a lot of after listening to me, right? So we're gonna talk about migraines, talk about headaches. Yep, everyone probably has one right now. Yep, that's okay. Anywho, we're gonna talk about the treatment of headaches and migraines going forward. So migraines will be the first thing we talk about. So we know frequently you're going to see female patients are going to be a little bit more predisposed to develop migraines. And typically the auras are kind of interesting because the gender distribution actually favors a little bit more, definitely more towards women without having aura. But, you know, and when it gets to men who have it, they're more likely to have the aura in comparison. It's kind of interesting to see that split there. Obviously, you know, you see a lot of younger patients, so especially at Nemours, I see a lot of these young ladies who are coming in. Like, you always wonder, it's like, 8 o'clock at night, and they have their sunglasses on in the room. The room's all dark, and you're just like, man, that's a cool kid, you know? And you're like, oh, no, they're having a migraine right now. That's why they have their sunglasses on. So again, you can find all patients of all ages may experience migraines. Frequently you'll see kind of new onset, kind of early on in age, and that's why I see a lot of those patients there. So, the actual pathophysiology is kind of complicated, but a lot of it's thought to be due to kind of spasticity of the blood vessels within the CNS. Essentially, what you're seeing, especially with the aura, can be kind of related back to kind of more vasoconstriction of the blood vessels in the CNS. And then when you actually have the migraine itself, you're having a lot of vasodilation. Okay, so that vasodilation can lead to kind of local edema and lead to a lot of pressure on things like the trigeminal nerve, which leads to a lot of the pain you're going to be experiencing there. Okay, so a lot of the medications we're going to use in order to treat these migraines are going to be focusing on constricting those blood vessels back down. Okay, so we're going to give drugs that are working on either serotonin receptors, primarily serotonin receptors, are going to be working to squeeze those blood vessels back down, release that pressure on those nerves, and relieve the pain. So we're going to certainly see that you can try non-pharmacologic and OTC therapy, and we'll see some new drugs we can use as far as prescription therapy goes. So certain things, stress management, relaxation, training, biofeedback can all be super useful, especially if patients know they have a particular trigger. Some patients get really stressed out, or like if every Wednesday night at 5 o'clock you end up having a migraine, like you learn your triggers and kind of figure out how to get around those if you can. Headache diaries can be really useful in this regard as well. Some people do better with just sleeping, getting better sleep. Regular exercise can help. So lots of different options for those patients. Common food triggers that you can see associated with migraines include alcohol, caffeine withdrawal, things that have high amounts of MSG in them, pickled foods, different things like that. Tyramine-containing foods we already mentioned, right? So things like aged cheeses and smoked meats and things like that can have high tyramine, which get converted over into catecholamines that can lead to these migraines. So lots of different things can make this occur. So the therapy we're going to look at can either be preventative or acute. So obviously things that are acute are going to be for kind of acute management of an active migraine. The more preventative therapy is going to be for more kind of chronic maintenance of that to try to prevent a migraine from occurring, right? So that means that some of the drugs we're actually going to use actually can cause migraine if given at too high a dose or given too quickly with some of the preventative meds. So that'll be one of those things, that kind of the tight ropes you have to walk when using some of these preventative therapies. We'll talk about those just a little bit. But basically, therapy should be based on the signs and symptoms and the frequency and duration of their headaches. So generally, you want to administer medications at the onset of headache if possible. You could also do it with them aura if they know beforehand. So if patients know they're going to have an aura, if they have, if they start to get really kind of photosensitive or phonophobic or something like that, and they know they're about to have a migraine, they can take their abortive therapy right then, right? So abortive therapy is the same as like kind of acute therapy for that. You're going to see that the medications themselves do not fix the aura. They don't really have any effect on those kind of neurologic symptoms, but they will it will be able to actually treat the specific pain itself. And typically, you're going to see you try to limit use of these medications to no more than 2 days per week, but certainly you can have some patients who are going to have more frequent than that. And so this can be a little bit more difficult to manage. Because you're going to see some of these medications, if you keep squeezing down on the blood vessels in the brain, what do you worry about? Ischemia, yeah. So we're about stroking out, and so that's why you're going to see some of the contraindications include time frames for when you've received some of these medications, right? Because you give too much of the vasoconstrictive effect, ischemia can occur. That's no good. So for acute treatment, obviously you want to start with the easy stuff. So for more mild to moderate migraines, you can try things like NSAIDs, other simple analgesics, so aspirin, naproxen, Excedrin normally has some aspirin in it. Acetaminophen is typically not super useful by itself. Yes. Abortive therapy, yeah. So, yeah, and so I go ahead and like take the medication, hopefully try to prevent it from occurring at the first point. They usually use the term like abortive therapy to just like.
I wasn't sure if you said aura or abortive.
Yep.
Okay.
Yep. Very frequently, when patients come in to see us in the ER, we'll give them Toradol or Ketorolac in the acute care setting, because again, that's a parenterally available NSAID that works very well for pain, right? So that's a good one. And then frequently for nausea, vomiting, you're going to see either our 5-HT3 receptor antagonist, things like ondansetron being used, but also you can get some benefit out of your phenothiazine. So I mentioned these in the GI section, but these will come up again when we talk about the antipsychotics. But this group is a group of dopamine-blocking drugs. They also have some anticholinergic effects that can be all useful for those nausea, vomiting symptoms. So promethazine or Finnergan's a big one, right? Finnergan is nice because it has like a rectal suppository formulation. If they can't take anything orally, give it IV as well. Metoclopramide or Reglan can be useful here. Compazine or prochlorperazine is another one that I see being used pretty frequently. They're all pretty much the same as far as efficacy goes, so it just depends on what your preference is. So then we get into more moderate severe migraines, and this is where we get to kind of the heavy duty drugs, right? So this is where we're going to start to see some of those contraindications and whatnot. So we have certain drugs that are ergots or vasoconstrictors. So again, I mentioned that fungus from the rye and St. Anthony's fire, also where you get LSD from. Pretty trippy. So the main ones you see there are going to be ergotamine tartrate. This one's either available orally or as a suppository. And then probably the one I see used more frequently is this dihydroergotamine. You'll sometimes see it being referred to as DHE. So if you ever see that, that's what I was referring to. Not DHEA, which is fish oil, but DHE. This one is either given as a nasal spray for a patient to kind of self-administer, or it'll be given parenterally. So I actually had a young girl, I was just working in the ER last Friday and then Sunday. And so I saw that, a young girl, probably like, 14 or 15, had her sunglasses on, 9 o'clock at night in the ER, in a dark room. She had ended up failing some of the other therapy. So these aren't usually the kind of first go-to. These are more kind of second line because we have some newer agents, but we were able to use this for her. And so she ended up getting a dose Friday and ended up feeling a little bit better. And then she got a dose Sunday as well. But she kind of manifested a lot of the side effects you see on some of these medications. So the way they work, though, is they're actually bind to these serotonin receptors, so the 5-HT1D and 1B, right? So we saw something like Zofran blocked 5-HT3 receptors, but these are working on the 1D and 1B receptors. And these are vasoconstrictive in nature, so they bind to those receptors and they constrict the blood vessels in the brain and kind of limit that blood flow, limit that pressure on those trigeminal nerves and things like that, and help limit that pain. You can also see them activating some of these kind of presynaptic receptors as well, and they'll actually decrease release of some peptides that are causing pain, vasodilation, inflammation. So kind of performing kind of dual duty there. Biggest thing you're going to see is, or nice thing you're going to see is that it's a long half-life, so you see kind of decreased recurrence of migraines from occurring again, which is nice. And then you're also going to see the intranasal form can be useful for patients who have nausea and vomiting, so you can kind of administer it themselves, even if they are, you know, kind of throwing up. Biggest side effects you're going to see is nausea and vomiting. You can see some muscle weakness, pain, and hypertension as well, right, because we're giving a vasoconstrictive drug. So this girl, as soon as we started to – so basically she came into the ED. We started her off with, you know, some fluids, right, because fluids kind of fixes everything. So give her a liter of fluids. You give her, she's about 70 kilos. So she's adult size roughly, and so we were able to give her, you know, a liter of fluids. We gave her some Toradol IV. We gave her some – on Dansetron, so we gave her about 4 milligrams, which is an okay starting dose for her. And then we talked to the neurologist, you know, to see what he had recommended if she'd been on, because you know, a lot of times you want to figure out what's worked for them before or what hasn't, right? Because you don't want to give them stuff that doesn't work for them because you're just wasting your time. So talked to the neurologist. He's like, yeah, go ahead and use DHE. So you know, a lot of the people are not super used to using this drug all the time because it's kind of older, kind of been supplanted by a lot of these other ones we'll talk about in a minute. But as soon as we started to infuse it, the girl's like, oh, stomach cramps, like really, really bad. So I was like, okay, well, this is a known side effect of the drug, and probably was keeping her mind off the headache more than anything. So it was probably useful in that regard. But we ended up having to give an extra dose of Zofran just to kind of help limit a lot of those cramps and deal with some of that nausea there. So she was kind of manifesting a lot of those kind of similar side effects. See a little bump in the blood pressure, but nothing too crazy with that. Okay, but the contraindications are important to know. You want to be careful patient of vascular or coronary disease, because again, you squeeze down all those vessels as well. Hypertension is a relative contraindication, so if it's kind of, you know, if their blood pressure is 180 over 100, probably don't want to give them anything else to raise their blood pressure, right? And then pregnancy is going to be a big one. This is a category X drug, terribly teratogenic. So again, what's the first thing you ask your patient, that 15-year-old girl? Are you pregnant? Are you sexually active? But mom's with her. Is she going to be telling the truth?
Can you pee on a stick?
Yeah, so oftentimes you either, you just go ahead and get a pregnancy test anyway, right? Because again, you never, better be safe than sorry in a lot of those cases. So you go ahead and get, you know, you can check a pregnancy test. You know, she had one that was negative like the week before from like her neurologist office, so we felt comfortable with that. So we went ahead and gave her the medication. But yeah, so really teratogenic, avoid that. And if impaired hepatic renal function, it's kind of a relative contraindication. So, after that, we have a little bit more kind of our newer drugs. These are going to be our triptans, and so these are going to be also 5-HT1B and 1B receptor agonists. Probably sumatriptan or Imitrex, probably everyone's heard of, right? It's kind of the first one that came about that really got a lot of got a lot of fame to it. Available both as a nasal spray. You can see it given subcutaneously. They have like auto injectors that patients can use themselves, even given orally. This is kind of a first generation agent. This is kind of one of the first ones to really come out. It still gets quite a bit of use, so we still will give this with some frequency. IV is available as well, so lots of different options if your patient's throwing up. And then you have lots of other ones here, which we'll go into more detail as we kind of delve into them later. So, as I mentioned, their mechanism, they agonize the 5-HT1D and 1B receptors, so they're vasoconstrictive. They also have all the same actions as you would see with the ergots, right? You're going to see it's very, very effective in a lot of patients. About 85% of patients have a good effect with it. About 40% of them are going to have recurrence in the same day, especially with the early generation agents, you know, the first generation like sumatriptan, because the half-life's not super long. So some of the other ones are going to get around that by having a longer half-life. So things like fovotriptan or rizatriptan can be something you can use to get around that. Okay, so that's one option. As far as side effects go, you can see due to the vasoconstrictive effects some chest tightness, pressure, and pain, some other kind of random things like paresthesias and dizziness. But for the most part, you're going to see the contraindications are very similar to the ergotamines, things like coronary artery disease, angina, MI, you know, cerebrovascular disease. This is not going to be as teratogenic, not nearly the same degree as DHE, so you could give this potentially to a pregnant patient. Obviously, you want to try to avoid giving meds if you can to a pregnant patient, but this one is not necessarily going to be absolutely teratogenic. Also note that you do not want to give this within 24 hours of your ergots. Why do you think that is?
Because
Exactly. So it'll constrict too much. So one of the best questions you can ask this patient as well when they come in is, what have you already taken for this? Right. So if they already have a prescription for Imitrex at home or for DHE, so you need to know what they've already taken, because that's going to influence what you're going to give them next. Right. Because you do not want to give them too much vasoconstriction. Otherwise, you worry about ischemia, especially in the brain. No good. So usually you're going to see that sumatriptan is kind of the gold standard. Most patients are going to respond well to this, especially after like subcutaneous injections. But again, due to that recurrence rate, you may start with this one. Most insurances are going to cover this. It's relatively cheap. You know, generics are available, and then you can kind of work on other agents if this one's not working for them. So the second generation agents are mainly designed to decrease that recurrence and increase the bioavailability of the drug. So if you're going to take an oral dosage form, have a little bit better percentage there you actually are absorbing, and hopefully to decrease some of the side effects. They are generally going to possess a little bit better receptor potency. So you know, they can use smaller doses to really get there and hit that receptor, and also have better lipophilicity to get into the CNS better. And it'll have longer half-lives. So all these things are kind of useful to help get around some of those problems we see with sumatriptan. So zolmitriptan or Zomig, this one has an ODT, which is an oral disintegrating tablet. So similar to what some of you would see like Zofran, if those available, or as a nasal spray. Very similar activity. So nothing new with that one. And then you have narotriptan or Emerge. This one has a high bioavailability and a longer half-life. So it's going to help to limit a lot of that recurrence you're going to be seeing there. So even though this one will actually have a slower onset, though, so at slower onset, so you're not going to see as quick of an effect as you would see with something like sumatriptan. So it can be one kind of trade-off you're going to run into with that drug. You have rizatriptan or Maxalt. This one has an ODT that's available. This one actually has a drug interaction if you give it with propranolol, which is important because when we talk about our preventative therapy, it can be one drug we try to use there. And this can actually see a 70% increase in the area under the curve or the amount of drug you're being exposed to with propranolol. So this would be one reduction you want to decrease the initial and the total daily dose of propranolol the patient is going to receive to prevent that interaction. So this one has a very fast onset, though, which can be useful. Patients really need kind of quick active relief of those headaches. Next, you have almotriptan. This one has pretty good bioavailability, but can be affected by things like CYP3A4 and monoamine oxidase. So if you have any inhibitors on board, that can increase your levels there and see more side effects. So one thing to worry about. You have fovertriptan or elotriptan, which also had that CYP3A4 issue. And then you have fovertriptan. Long half-life, though, very long, so 25 hours or so. So you're not going to see a ton of recurrence associated with that one just because it sticks around for longer. So basically for this acute treatment, use your migraine-specific agents in patients with severe migraine who have responded poorly to your initial NSAIDs, right? Whether it be, you know, Toradol, whether it be ibuprofen, whatever they took. And again, that's another thing to ask questions, especially if they're coming into like an ER or something. Like if they've already taken a bunch of NSAIDs, you don't necessarily want to give them Toradol on top of that. You increase your risk for GI toxicity and stuff. But if you can use a non-oral route for earlier significant nausea vomiting, right, to get around that because they can't keep it down, obviously not going to absorb it very well. And if you're going to give a drug sub-Q, give it about 1 hour to work, right? That's probably the fastest onset other than IV. And then for more intranasal or PO forms, you have to give about 2 hours or so to kick in, right? So this is why you're still giving them fluids, you're giving them NSAIDs, maybe acetaminophen to try to help kind of get them through this initial period until the drug can really start to kick in. Again, do not use triptans within 24 hours of an ergot or other triptans just due to that prolonged vasospasm. So keep that in mind. And then you try to avoid using the drugs 2 days per week of abortive therapy. Again, you hopefully can try to find some more like kind of preventative measures if you can, if they're having this frequent of symptoms, because again, you just worry about that kind of prolonged vasospasm. Okay. So next we'll talk about medication overuse headaches. As you might imagine, this happens when? There's too many meds, right? Stop using drugs. They're bad. So this is going to be associated with patients who are overusing things like urogodamines, your triptans, and even other things like opioids, right? Maybe some patients might require an opioid, hopefully not too many. But this is going to be for patients who are having headaches, say, greater than, you know, 15 days per month, and they're using ergots, triptans, and even opioids maybe 10 days or more per month, right? So there's a very frequent use of these. Basically, you just try to switch them over to a different medication that may work a little bit better for them. Try to use more better preventative meds, and this will actually resolve over time. So basically, the patient's getting this kind of hypersensitivity to where every time they get a headache, they're treating this, and eventually they're kind of losing efficacy over time. But if you resolve and discontinue those medications, within about 2 months or so, they should kind of get back to normal. So, again, if they're, you know, if you're using something like 7 to 12 analgesic tabs or capsules per day, try to discontinue the analgesic. For a lot of these, you can discontinue abruptly, but you may try to taper down for your patient just so they feel a little bit better. And then you can begin a prophylactic medication. So we'll talk about what those are in a little bit. And again, you can see withdrawal symptoms sometimes lasting for days to weeks. But again, by tapering down, hopefully you can kind of avoid some of that when doing that. And if they're taking more than 12 analgesic tabs or caps per day, or if they're pregnant, do not abruptly discontinue, because you can see a lot of worsening side effects from that, a lot of worsening headaches. So those are going to need a lot better, longer kind of taper before you see withdrawal, you know, kind of rebound headaches. So who might be a candidate for preventative therapy? Those are having kind of recurrent or frequent migraine that's interfering with their kind of daily routines. If they have a contraindication to any acute treatment, this might be a good option for them. Or they're having kind of significant ADRs, or they can't really tolerate other the abortive therapies. They can't handle the cost, or if it's just patient preference. So this may be, have a conversation with your patient to see if these are going to be useful for them. So first line, you can use beta blockers. Right, so this is useful for about 80% of patients. And as you might imagine, beta blockers do what to the blood vessels? Should dilate them, right? Hopefully. Exactly, wouldn't that cause a headache, right? So this is why you have to start low dose and titrate up very slowly, because otherwise you can actually induce a migraine in some of these patients, right? But the idea is, if you have kind of a baseline small amount of vasodilation, you're less likely to see whatever kind of inciting event really cause significant vasodilation, right? You're kind of setting your baseline a little bit differently so that whatever comes along, it can't really affect it that much, right? That's the way I kind of think about it. Obviously, propranolol might not be useful for what type of patients? Who might you not want to use it in?
19
people. Hmm? So people, yeah, so elderly patients who may have CNS changes might not be good for them. Who else? Is it selective or non-selective? It's non-selective. Yeah, asthmatics might not be a good option for it. So certainly other beta blockers could be useful as well. Atenolol, metoprolol, all those can be used. Again, they may be blocking vasodilation from occurring by kind of having that kind of baseline effect there. And it may actually also help to inhibit some serotonin release from platelets, which may be thought to have some effect in causing the migraines there. You may see some other anticonvulsants being used sometimes, so things like divalproic or valproic acid can be used. This is actually thought to kind of inhibit this kind of early wave spreading of depression that can occur for some of these patients. And then Topamax is another one you'll see used very frequently for prevention of migraine. So again, remember that one has some carbonic anhydrase inhibiting effects, blocking some calcium channels, blocking some glutamate channels, kind of doing everything. And you're starting to see this one become used more frequently as a first-line agent to help prevent migraines, right? You guys remember the side effects from looking at that. Some other things you can use, tricyclic antidepressants, SSRIs. A lot of these are not used as frequently, but if patients have kind of failed beta blockers, if they've failed things like topiramate, there might be other options they can try using here. Again, these take a while to really kick in and have their effects, usually about 6 weeks or so. So just let your patients know that they're not going to be immediately effective. But again, we'll talk more about these as we get into the behavioral section later on in the class. Some calcium channel blockers can be useful here as well. So things like verapamil can be used sometimes, and very similar to the beta blockers, you have to start low dose, gently titrate up, because you may actually cause an aura or cause a migraine to occur. You may see some effects with nifedipine, which is what type of calcium channel blocker? Nifedipine would be a dihydropyridine, right? Verapamil being a non-dihydropyridine, right? So those are kind of the two main ones you're going to see being used. But for patients who have, especially if they have like a lot of like tension type headaches, or have a lot of like kind of muscle spasms leading to the migraines, botulinum toxin can be used as well. So sometimes you see it being used like in the neck muscles and stuff in order to help kind of limit that and kind of relieve that headache. So always start low, go slow. Don't want to induce a migraine if you can avoid it. And then assess for the frequency, duration, intensity of attacks. Hopefully, success is kind of considered to be a drop in at least 50% or more. Okay, continue for at least 2 to 3 months, kind of continually reassess to see how they're benefiting from this, and try to avoid any interfering medications. Obviously, don't mix a beta blocker with a non-dihydropyridine, because that really doesn't make a whole lot of sense. And also, consider the other coexisting comorbidities. So do they have asthma? Do they have diabetes? Like, what are some things you may want to avoid when initiating these meds? Okay, so I'm probably going to go ahead and cut it there. I'll finish out this section and then go on into the next one next week. Any questions? Good job on the test. Keep it up. You only have, 2 more quizzes and 3 more tests to do? Yes. All right.
Times five.
Keep on keeping up.
Times five.
Times five. Yeah. There you go. Yeah, okay. That's easy.